Nope. Better now. Take it down just a little bit. Talk silently, not that silently. Good morning, everybody. If that didn't wake you up already, I'm excited to see each and every one of you here. Thank you for being out or being here. Remember those who are out. We've got a ton of families traveling today. As Vince told you, the whole youth group's in Florida, which means all the youth leaders are in Florida and everybody else. And then I had a ton of people hit me up, and they were like, hey, man, don't take it offensive when I don't go to church Sunday. We've already had a vacation plan. So be praying for those people. But I'm going to start us off in a word of prayer, so if you all would bow your heads. Dear Heavenly Father, as we come for today, God, I just thank you, Lord, for bringing us back in your presence, bringing us back in your house, God. Whether we be here, God, in person, God, or whether we be on live stream wherever we are, cast far and wide all over the United States today, God, I just ask, God, that you be in our presence wherever we are, God. God, that we feel you and we experience you like never before, God, that you use me like you've never used me before, God. You speak through me. You don't let me speak up or speak out, God, but it is you and only you who speaks through me this morning, God, and gives each and every one of us what we need to hear, God. God, I thank you and I praise you for what you've already done through the worship team this morning, God, and I praise you for what you're about to do as we go throughout the rest of this service and what you're going to do in our lives throughout this week, God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So as I was preparing for this message, I didn't put all of it together, and I did put all of it together, but I didn't put certain situations together until I got this morning, and God kind of changed my scripture a little bit, and it's going to be kind of funny, and I'm not in any way relating the scripture to what the story I'm about to tell you is, but it kind of was. It was about a month ago, me and my wife took a vacation to Myrtle Beach, and we always go with no itinerary. Like, we don't have any plans. We don't make plans. I do schedules for a living. I don't want to have a schedule when I'm on vacation, so we always go, and we're like, whatever happens, happens. Wherever we eat, and whatever we do, we do. So we decided to go. They got this little downtown area where it's got, like, arcades and food and all that, and we're walking through there, strolling, checking everything out, and this guy stops us. Hey, guys, I've got an exciting offer just for you. Mother flip, I know exactly what this is about to be. If you've ever been on vacation before, you know exactly where this story is going. Like, man, yeah, we ain't got time for that. You just hear me out. It's not as bad as you think it is. What you got? Because he trapped us in a store. He's like, man, what are y'all doing for fun? There's been a lot of storms out. They're forecasting more storms. What are y'all doing for fun this vacation? I was like, I don't know, man. Like, we're just flying by the seat of our pants, as old people used to say. I don't know what we're going to do. That's the point of vacation. What if I offer you something exciting for your family? Okay, what? He lists off all these places. And, of course, now he's got my kids hooked. That's step one in the process. Kids hear all these places. They're like, Dad, 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 just listen, just listen. So I listen. He's like, and I'm going to offer you guys a 7 days vacation, all of our resorts, anywhere in the world. You guys just pick the place, and you get to go. And I was like, yeah, what's the catch? Well, you just got to sit through this hour and a half is all you're required to stay at, 90 minutes. And as soon as that 90-minute marks, you can leave. I was like, 90-minute hit, I can walk out of there. Yeah, 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 there's nothing going to hold you down. He's like, okay. So he told us about this great vacation, showed us all the places, showed us what we could do. He wrote down all the paperwork, was like, you know what? We ain't got no plans tomorrow. We can waste an hour and a half. I've heard of my friends doing this. They came out with some great vacations, so we'll do it. So we go to the place the next day. And when I tell you these people know how to sell, they know how to sell. They come in and, well, first off, buddy told us, buffet, and I've been dieting recently, but I was not dieting on the vacation. And when he said buffet, I was thinking, man, you know, you think buffet, especially in Florida, especially if they're trying to catch you on, you know, sell you something, it's going to be a nice buffet. It was all you could eat chicken fingers. Anyways, I digress. I was not happy about that, but they take us in there, and they, you know, first off, the salesman sat down and ate lunch with us. Was not expecting that. I was thought presentation, but whatever. He sits down. He gets to know us. Hey, guys, you know, what's your hobbies? What do you like doing? And he asked my wife, and this is one thing that rung out in my head, and you'll catch it later on in this story I'm telling. One thing stuck out in my head, he asked my wife, he's like, what's one place you've always wanted to go? And we're just having a conversation with the dude, so my wife tells him. He's like, all right, cool. He keeps talking, goes through the conversation. He's like, all right, guys, so here's what's about to happen. I'm going to take you upstairs. I'm going to show you the room. We're going to walk through everything, and then we'll come back down here, and I'll show you the numbers, what it's looking like, and all this. And me and my wife had done had a conversation. I was like, we're not buying anything, right? Me and Brittany, yeah, we're not buying anything. We're not buying anything. As soon as this 90 minutes hits, I'm done. I'm going to tell them I'm walking out. By the time lunch was over, I didn't even realize 45 minutes had passed. This dude sat there and talked to us for 45 minutes. He takes us up, takes us through the room. That takes another 45 minutes. We're at an hour and a half, and we ain't even talked about numbers yet. But we get down there. They hit us with the 1-2 punch of showing us these outrageous numbers after they've done take us into the room, and the jacuzzis are going, and they got fresh. They got somebody in there cleaning, so it smells all fresh all the time, and they done baked a batch of fresh cookies, and he took us out to the deck and told us to look at the ocean and imagine ourselves sitting on the deck enjoying a vacation. All this stuff. I mean, it was great. Nice room, nice hotel. Takes us down there, shows us the numbers, and he's like, hey, man, it's just this amount. I don't know who the flip you think you stopped walking through that little discount mart, but it wasn't somebody rich. Oh, let me talk to my manager. So they talks to the manager. Manager comes over. How you doing, young man? Good. Let me tell you about this exciting offer. I just had it come across my desk. This is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. I'm not going to be able to offer it to anybody else today besides you. Here you go. Y'all obviously still ain't getting the fact that I'm broke. So we're still talking. We're upwards in the thousands of dollars a month. And I'm like, I can't afford that. y'all can knock it down half, and I still can't afford that because that's still like $1,500 a month. Well, you seem unsure. I'm not unsure. I'm telling you, I'm broke. Like, I know my bank account. I suffer with it. I fight with it every day. I know my bank account. I'm broke. I've been broke all my life. I'm going to stay broke probably for, unless something happens. I'm probably going to stay broke. So I know I'm broke. You ain't got to tell me. All right, we'll get you out of here. Just, let me go get some paperwork. See, he goes around. I see him hitting other tables. I'm like, this dude ain't getting no mother flipping paperwork. He just holding me up thinking I'm going to change my mind. So he comes back. We thought any more about it? I was like, no, we ain't thought any more about it because I'm still broke. That was the forethought. There's no other thoughts to be had. Well, let me show you this other place. Completely off somewhere in Tennessee. I'm like, we came to Myrtle Beach for the beach, and you offer me someplace in Tennessee with no view. And he's like, yeah, but you don't understand. You can swap. I'm like, all right. I'm listening a little bit. He's, what's the price? Here it is. It's half the price that I showed you earlier. No, still too high. So he walks around again, comes back, and he's like, my manager just slid me something. My boss. And my other boss is out of town, so I'm going to cut you this great deal. I'm going to do this. The deposit's going to be cheaper than that. And we go through this 3 or 4 more times. And they look at me every other time that they're offering this stuff, and they go, but your wife said she wanted to go here. And that was her dream. You're going to take your wife's dream from her? Yes, I am, because guess what? I'm still broke. I don't think you understood that part. But he took us through all this stuff, and we walked out of there probably 3 hours later, and I was like, my God, that was a horrible experience. It was not worth it. But we got our stuff. We got the little entertainment package they had offered us for the day. We got the lunch they had offered us for the day, and we got the vacation at the end of it. I was like, everything's good. I suffered through 3 hours for a 7 days vacation. And then I start looking at the pamphlet, and I'm like, all right, so what all places can we go? Oh, we can go here, we can go here. And I'm like, oh, what's all this fine print at the bottom? Oh, there's a processing fee. Oh, there's a cleaning fee. Oh, there's a maintenance fee. And by the time I added it all up, I'm like, we could have just flipped and stayed where we stayed this week for the same price. And As I got to thinking about this message, and this is the funny part that I said, I got to thinking about Job. And I'm not in any way comparing what I said through, comparing it to the book of Job. But we always expect the devil to come just like those people did and lay out the price. That's what I was hoping would happen, was him to just come across the table and go, here's the price. I can go, no, because I'm broke. And that'd be the end of it. But the devil don't work that way. The devil will never walk up to a chain and put you in bondage and say, hey, dude, ain't this cool? And hand you a 10-pound log chain, because he knows we would reject it, right? Everybody in here is going to go, no, I'm not carrying around a log chain. Like, what's your problem? So the devil don't do that. He comes up and he goes, here, just hold on to this. What am I holding on to this for? Oh, it's nothing. Look, it don't weigh nothing. It don't hardly catch that Lamont. It don't hardly do nothing. It's weightless, right? There ain't nothing to it. It's just a carabiner. But see, we suffer through so many things in our life. And if he'd have came at Job the same way, he knew if I just take everything from Job all at once, he'd probably just cry out to God. So I'm going to come at it to him in moments. And see, we get hit with things in moments, like somebody cut us off. So we cussed them out going down the road. And they ruined our entire day because they cut us off in traffic. Or, and this is one we're not ready for as a church, we're holding on to our family's trauma that ain't got nothing to do with us. But Dad used to be an alcoholic. Or, you know, my mom had anger issues. And I'm supposed to have anger issues. And, you know, every time I get mad, that's probably where my anger issues come from. And we go through, and pretty soon, we've got a little bit of a chain going. But it's okay, because, you know, still don't weigh that much. It's just, it ain't got me captive. There's nothing holding me to it. There's nothing that has really tied me down from doing anything for God. There's nothing on here I can't lay down. But we come to church. Bobby Sue just looked at me the wrong way, and I just, it rubbed me the wrong way. And we hold on to that, and that grudge gets added to it. And we begin linking ourselves to all kinds of stuff that happens on the news, stuff that happens at work, stuff that happens at school. Pastor didn't pray for me when I asked him to. And we don't realize what the devil's doing to us, because he's brought us something with color. And then the part that really gets good, and this is where the devil really gets the church in a chokehold, is he goes, I'm going to add purpose to it. Because now, that's not just a carabiner or a chain link. It's a keychain. It's just a really, really, really long keychain. Stylish. I got these things. I was like, I got to find something that looks pretty. I can't go up there and just link a bunch of chains together, because people ain't going to really understand that. I got to find something that's got some color, that's going to look pretty. And sure enough, I brought it home. My daughter and my wife stole like two or three of them before I even got them out of the package. So obviously it done what I was expecting. But we add purpose to our problems. Because as long as our problems have purpose, then they're not problems. Just like our testimonies. We are not meant to live in our testimonies. You're meant to talk about your testimonies. Your testimonies are supposed to be part of your past. They're supposed to be part of how you came to Christ, not part of how you live in Christ. The problem with Christians is we talk so much about how our past held us down, and so much about how we used to be mad, and we used to be angry, and we used to be on drugs, and we used to do this, and we used to do that, that we're still holding on to it. And then our purpose becomes part of our problem again. See, all throughout the story of Job, I'm sure many of you know the story of Job, but Job went through it. Job 1:12, it talks about, you know, the devil came up and he was like, hey, you know, he came up to Jesus or God and he was like, hey, I've just been roaming to and fro on earth, walking back and forth, looking for somebody. And God said, you can do whatever you need to do, but you can't kill him. So the devil came to him and he poked holes all in his armor, as many holes as he could. And see, the devil will never come to you and completely destroy you, because he knows if he comes to you and completely destroys you and you turn from God, everybody's going to look at you and go, oh, he just turned from God. That's not how the devil captives all of America. That's not how the devil tears down the church. He comes to you and he pokes holes in your armor and he makes you sin while you're still saying you're a Christian, and he makes you live in bondage while you're still a Christian, and he makes you look depressed, and he makes you come in here to church and be sad all the time, and he makes you come to church every Sunday and never get nothing from it and still live in torment and torture every day and still claim to be a Christian, because he knows, just as Job's friends did after the devil took his children from him, after he took his property from him, his friends came and saw him, and they became in agony with him. They tore off the robes, and they cried out to the heavens. And they just sat in silence. Because the devil knows, if he don't want to just tear down one person, he wants to take down the whole church. Because he knows if he can take down a church, he's took down one more vessel of God. He took one more light away from the community of hope. Took one more light away from the Rock Mart. He took one more light away from North Georgia. So we don't pay attention to all these little things that the devil keeps doing, and pretty soon, we've got enough to hold our hands down. We've got enough bondage to keep our hands from going up. Now this has some weight to it. Now this has some issues to it. But see, another problem with Christians is we don't go, man, I got to get rid of this mess. This mess is just taking me down. I can't live in bondage. I can't walk back into church and not get nothing out of it. I can't walk back into worship and not worship God, because, you know, I can't sing because, you know, I'm using that as an excuse not to cry out to God, because I'm not here for the purpose of pleasing your ears. I'm here for the purpose of pleasing God. I'm not here to worship you. I'm not here to make it tickle your ears and make it sound good to you. As long as God can hear my voice crying out to him, that's all I'm here for. But we come in here and we let these little things hold us down, and we don't realize that the devil's using all these little things to build against us. But then we begin to wear all the bondage that the devil has created, all these little bondages, all these little things that never meant nothing, that never were going to do anything. And we begin to wear them as accessories, because we've become so accustomed to them. You know, I'm still well short of my journey of losing weight, but I've lost about 20 pounds. And I didn't realize when I was carrying that 20 pounds around how much 20 pounds was. Because when you're carrying around 20 pounds of fat, your body, it because the fat don't come all at once. If all of a sudden you weighed 400 pounds and you used to weigh 2, you probably see the problem. It's the same way the enemy works in our life. It's the same way termites work on a home. He's never going to come at you all at once. He never came at Job all at once. He picked at him and picked at him. He had his wife pick at him. Why don't you just cry out? Why don't you just renounce God? Why don't you just curse him and turn? Job done everything. He cursed the day that he was born, but he never cursed God. But as long as you use what the devil has created as bondage in your life as an accessory, as long as you continue to allow the devil to add on to it each and every day and you keep making excuses for it, As long as you keep making excuses for your anger, and you make excuses for things that you know God has not called you to, and moments that God has not called you to, that chain's going to keep getting longer and longer and longer. That was a little bitty keychain when I first pulled it up. Actually, it was a little bitty carabiner. It had no purpose. People wouldn't you couldn't put keys on a carabiner. I had to give it purpose. We always give our problems purpose so that everybody else can't see. We cover them up with our smiles and our laughter when we come to church so that nobody really knows what's going on. But God has called us to so much more than what you've been holding on to. God has called you to so much more than the anger that's in your life, than you not being able to go a moment without drinking, than you not being able to go a moment without doing drugs. He's called you to so much more than the past traumas that you keep saying is a testimony, but they really become part of your daily story. There's an old saying that if you lay with dogs, you'll catch fleas. If you lay in bondage, you'll catch chains. If you lay in bondage, pretty soon the devil's going to go, hey, this don't weigh that much. Here, just hold on to that for just a second. I need you to hold on to that for just a second. I'm just going to hold on to it. Don't make a big fuss about it. If I don't make a big fuss about it, it's not that big of a thing. And God's like, just cry out to me. I'm trying, God. Oop, about to set my alarm off. I'm trying, God. God's like, just lift your hands and break through, because that's all I need you to do. And we don't pay attention to all the little things holding us on. We look for things like, oh, I'm not doing drugs, or I'm not an alcoholic, or, I come to church on Sundays, and I do pray, and I do read. And we let all these other little things hold us in bondage, and they keep us from the glory of God, and they keep us from seeing what God can really do in this church. And then we go, God, why ain't you moving? He's like, you didn't lift your hands. Yeah, you did. I was in church. You don't understand. I led Bible study. You don't understand. I led worship. But you never broke free. Yeah, you did, God. See, when I came to church, I came up there and I gave you all. I had depression, and I laid my depression on the altar. And I had alcoholism, and I hadn't drank since. And I was addicted to drugs, and I hadn't done drugs since. See, God, I gave it to you, so why can't I find peace? Why can't I find freedom? And God's going, well, you look at your hands. You never raised them to me. These little things, these little links, are what has kept America in bondage for so long. It's what kept the church in bondage for so long. It's the reasons that we don't see things like we saw in the biblical days. It's the reasons that we don't see God move like we saw him move back in. It's the reasons that we can't call out miracles like we used to. It's the reasons that we can't call out past traumas like we used to. It's the reasons we can't call out spirits of the enemy and we say, get thee away from there. It's the reasons that we can't break free from the bondage, because everything that we've done has been linked back to us. Everything that we do has been linked back to our problems. Everything, we're linking it to our family, or we're linking it to our coworkers. Our coworkers just made us mad. Or my family's had all this past trauma you don't understand. I'm fighting through these things. It's okay to fight through them, but you cannot let them hold you down. God has so much more for this church. He has so much more for you in your individual lives, in your worship lives, in your spiritual lives, in your reading lives. He's got so much for this church as a whole. He's got so much more for the community of Rockmart. He's got so much more for Northwest Georgia. But we're never going to see it as a church or as a Christian as long as we hold our hands like this. The enemy don't always come in like a flood. It's not always somebody handing you a joint. It's not always somebody convincing you to smoke crack. It's not always somebody handing you another beer bottle. It's not always somebody saying it's okay to do that and get mad and punch somebody. It's not always big moments. You think the devil don't take lessons from God? He realizes that Christians, sometimes they need small moments. Sometimes they need still voices. Sometimes they need pretty colors like rainbows to draw them in. Things that we can wear as accessories. If I were to give you a 20-pound weight and tell you to hold it or carry it around, you wouldn't do it. If I were to carry around a 20-pound weight, I wouldn't do it. But when it comes on like weight, or we get used to it because it came a day at a time or a month at a time, the devil's going to give you long enough to become accustomed to what you're living in. The enemy is going to let you soak in those moments long enough that they become mindsets. But you cannot allow your moments to become mindsets, because if they become mindsets, then your mind will never be set on God. I can't tell you what your future holds, but I can tell you who holds your future. I can't tell you what the doctor said about your medical experiences, but I can tell you who can heal you. I can't tell you how you're going to die, when you're going to die, how long you're going to be on this earth, but I can tell you who's going to meet you at the end of it. But you've got to let go of all of this. God gave us one link that would break free of everything. And that was Jesus. And that's all you need. Lamont came up and prayed it, and he didn't even know what he was praying, part of my message. We've complicated the Word of God so much, and it's really not that complicated. He said it to the, I heard him say it to the worship team, it's just words on the screen. He said it to me, it's just the gospel. All you've got to do up there is go and prepare the gospel. As long as you preach the gospel, you ain't got to worry about nothing else. As long as we hold on to the gospel and we realize these moments that are holding us, these characteristics that are holding us, these family traumas that we've let hold us to, that we've linked ourselves to, they're just links. Links that can be undone. You'll truly experience what it's like to be free in Christ. But you're not going to ever experience God until you go, there's my anger. Until you go, they cut me off. But it's not going to define my day. Until you go, my family had trauma, I don't. Until you go, I had depression. Had being the key word. Until those moments, until those chains, until those little things that you've let consume your lives, until those little termites, those little pounds of weight come up here and get laid on this altar, this church is never going to see God for who he truly is. Because this is only a half surrender. This means I need help. This means I surrender all. But you're never going to get to this while your hands are tied to this. Job went through so much. But Job recognized that I'm still God's. He even at one point said, God, he realized no matter what he had been through, what his family went through, what his land had went through, all the stuff that he had that got took away from him, all that stuff got stripped away, and he still realized God had his hand upon him because he asked God to take it off of him. How far do you got to be into Christ's hand to know, I don't care what my doctor said, I don't care what, you know, my children may have died, my property may have perished, my animals may be gone, my future may look bleak. but I still know God's got me. How deep is your faith in that? Because God, the same God that was the God of Job, is the same God that is the God you're worshiping today. The same one that done miracles in the Bible, the same one that moved mountains in the Bible, the same one that raised the dead and all that, we're still serving the same God. He hasn't changed. Our faith has. He hasn't changed. Our bondage has. As we become more modernized, as we've complicated the Word of God even more, we've also complicated our faith even more. What we've experienced today, what we experience in church today, has become a watered-down faith and a watered-down version of what God had set forth in the Bible. I'm not saying anything bad about our church or anything. What we have accustomed ourselves to in the Word of God has been from that of mouths of preachers who have watered down the Word of Christ. And I'm not talking about Vince. I'm talking about generation upon generation has watered it down a little more and a little more. And they've added to it and took away from it a little more and a little more. And they've done this a little more until they've put bondage on the church. And they've okayed this, and it's okay to do that, and it's okay to suffer through this, and it's okay if you do this every now and then. And we've okayed so much stuff that we're not truly experiencing Christ like they used to. And that's why. God is still alive like he's never. God is more relevant today than he has ever been before. God is more apparent today than he's ever. We know the end of the story. Could you imagine how much more faith those people in the Bible would have had if they would have knew the end of the story? They had faith so strong, just like Job. You couldn't have broke his faith. You couldn't break his faith. And he didn't even know the end of the story. You know the end of the story. You know who wins. You know who holds your future. You know who holds your life. So why is it so hard to praise him? This morning as the worship team comes back around, my challenge to you is quit downplaying all the little things in your life. Quit downplaying the little bondages in your life. Because just like you're one link away from bondage, you're one link away from freedom. Because all it takes is one link to be broke and you're free again. But if you keep going, that one more link is going to hold you from ever being able to raise your hands. That one more link that gets added to your life that you've okayed and downplayed will hold you out of church. It'll make an excuse for tomorrow, and then that excuse will be an excuse for later on down the road, and then it'll be an excuse not to pray, and it'll be an excuse not to open the Bible, and it'll be an excuse not to watch preaching online. It'll be all these excuses, and all these excuses will take you slowly out of the hands of God and slowly out of church. And then everybody else will go, oh, they were a great Christian. And that's what the devil's plan is. Oh, they were a great Christian. I watched them worship God. They went through some stuff. I watched them. And now they're, what? Is something going on with the church? Something going on with the pastor? Is something, am I reading the Bible wrong? And then he creeped into somebody else's life. Because as I've told you guys many a times, you may be the only Bible that somebody else reads. Your life may be the only open Bible that somebody ever reads. That may be the only way they get to ever see Christ. That may be the only way they get to experience God is by seeing you live. What's your storytelling? This morning, let go of every link of bondage that you've had, no matter how small it seems, no matter how much it weighs, let go and let God, because I promise you God wants to do something miraculous in your life.
I speak the name.
man. Y'all give the worship team a round of applause one more time. They done a great job today. Vince has got an ending video for us, so y'all can all sit down. I don't know how long it's going to be. I just wanted to leave you guys with this. Don't let things creep in throughout the week. Because what I've seen a lot of is people will go through stuff throughout the week and they'll go, I'll just pray about it on Sunday, or I'll talk to the pastor on Sunday. And then they don't come to church on Sunday. Because one thing after one thing after one thing after one thing, and then pretty much they're like, I don't even feel like going. God wants to do something amazing in this church, but we've got to surrender all. All. That's the key word that God's been trying to tell us through so many things there lately. He wants it all. All the bondage, all the strife, all the worry, all everything that could possibly keep you from him, all the things that you don't even realize are keeping you from him. He wants it all. Remember to pray for everybody coming as they come back. Pray for the youth. They get a blessing every year, and they come back a blessing. They got Youth Sunday coming up August 6th, I believe, or something like that. And Asia is going to be speaking. So pray for them. Pray that they always come back fired up from it. Pray that they see God like they've never seen him before. Because that's what they go out there and they have fun and they get to do all these cool things. But that's what the main point of this trip is about. Is so they see God on a more personal level like they've never seen him before. So pray that they truly experience that in the time they have left and on the way back down here. And pray that they have safe travels, and pray that Vince don't get any more gray hairs, because all I could see was gray since he wants to throw jabs at me on text messages saying I'm not broke. Y'all have a great Sunday. Vince has got something to say.
Man, what a fantastic message, Quentin. Abigail, you guys did fantastic this morning. Church was phenomenal. I wish that I could have been there in person, but I was not able to be there because, like I said, I'm down here in Florida with our students. But, man, church was great. I appreciate you guys coming to worship with us. Hey, we got a few quick announcements. Youth starts back up August the 13th. August the 4th, we're going to have our family night. If you're interested in going to Stars and Strikes, please let Quentin know, let myself know, let Wayne know, let someone know so that we can go ahead and book this thing up. The cost, I think, is going to be right around $28. We'll firm that up just a little bit. I'll let you guys know this week the exact cost. Also, August the 5th, students, make sure you check out Telegram. We got a lot of stuff coming up. August the 5th, August the 6th is going to be our student takeover. August the 13th, we got our church fish fry. So make sure you make plans to join that. August 27th, we have our church luau. We have a ton of things going on. And look at this. Check it out. Boom. Church bus down here in Florida. Got us down here safely. It's going to make us back home safely. And we have other stuff that's going to be coming up. Our children's are going to launch back up August the 13th. Things are just moving in motion. We've done a lot of construction on the church. Things are happening left and right and left. It has been fantastic watching all this stuff happen. So listen, that brings me to the last part of our worship session this morning. This is our extended part of worship. This is the moment in time where we ask you to give. And I said every time, give out of conviction, not out of convenience. Ask God, hey, what would you have me give this morning? What would you have me give? Because whatever God calls you to give and you do it, God can use it for his glory. But I want you to give out of obedience, not out of obligation. Give out of conviction, not out of convenience. And watch what God does. Who knows? God may use whatever you give for us to buy another one of these. Because I promise you, God is doing something great at North Church. And eventually, this is not going to be enough. Can't wait to see you guys next week. I will be back, and I'm going to be preaching. And then the following week, Asia's going to be preaching. We got a lot of things happening at North. Stay connected. Love you guys. Bye.